This conference will now be recorded.
Fine. So in the last session, we discussed about multi-org structure. So this is what we call as multi-org structure, which is maintained with some hierarchy. Top level, we have BZ under BZ, primary ledger, under primary ledger, legal entity, under LE, operating unit, and operating unit. Under operating unit, we have inventory organization. This is standard multi-org structure. Multi-org stands for multiple organizations. Just we are, instead of taking the multiple organization structure, we are using the short name, multi-org. Okay. This hierarchy is standard as per applications. So we cannot change it. Based on the system setups, what we do, automatically system will build this kind of hierarchy across the applications. The first point is multi-org structure, and this is a hierarchy. The second point is what level, which modules we map. These are the points we discussed. BZ level, HRMS applications, primary ledger level, GL and FA, and legal entity level, cash management. And most of the applications are mapped at operating level. The reason, operating is the place where we perform the real business transactions. The real business activities takes place in the real business. So that is the reason all the most of the applications are mapped at operating unit level. As per our discussions, what are the modules we discussed, accordingly we taken few applications here, APR, POOF. These applications are mapped at operating unit level. When I talk about inventory, so inventory organizations level, we map inventory application, Oracle inventory. There are many other applications which will be mapped in the different levels, but that information is not important for us. We are not going to deal with those applications. That is the reason completely we can ignore it. Done. So some other points we discussed, if client is going to use some third party applications other than Oracle, how to connect, some integration and all, very based on those questions which we got from few participants, we discussed those points. But anyway, we'll discuss about how integrations will work and all. And here we taken the few examples for multi-org structures. Here we take in the case, client has three branches in three cities. So the same we represented as a three operating units. So in that case, the three operating units are under same legal entity since they have one registration. And for each operating unit, the one or multiple inventory organization, how they have in their business, how they are running the business, accordingly you can design the solution. So for Hyderabad operating unit, we take in two inventories. And for Bangalore one, for Chennai, by treating Chennai operating it there into services, no inventory is specified. Even business may not have a real inventory. System point of view, you have to create inventory. If they don't have real inventory, you have to create the dummy inventory. Okay, dummy inventory organization you have to create. The reason is to complete the setups for operating it, to use to record any business transactions for any operating it. So we have to associate inventory organization with operating it, otherwise we cannot use that operating net. Okay, because of that rule or say condition, if no inventory for specific operating net, you have to create dummy one. And here we taken one more example, as they're running the business in three locations. So the three we taken as a three operating units, but for two locations they have one registration. Since the two locations of business falls under electronics business, so separate two legal entities we have to create in the system based on their registrations. So accordingly we have to design the solution in the system. So these are the points we discussed. Apart from that, so when you talk about instance, if the client has a business in three countries business, they can, the three countries business information they can maintain in the same instance by designing the solution with the concept called as multi-org. So if you are going to have three countries business in the single instance, data sharing and reporting will become very easy. And if client is going to have client is running the business in many countries, in that case they may plan how many instances they have to maintain. So for the maintenance and other many other reasons, they can plan and they can just go with the multiple instances also. In the most of the cases, we just normally suggest the client to go with a single instance. Okay. So that, so these are the points we discussed. The very first point when we are doing the implementation, we have to understand the client business and we have to design the multi-org structure. Okay, we discussed all the points, what points we have to consider when we design the multi-org structure. Okay, so the multi-org structure, simply you can call as organization structure also. Okay, the first point is we have to design. Before designing, we have to understand client business, not detail level. The detail level will understand when we are doing the specific application implementation. But so in the very initial stage, we have to understand the business very high level. Okay, so based on that, we have to design multi-org structure. Say multi-org solution, you can say our structure will design, but multi-org solution, or we have to design the organization structure, you can say. We can use the different naming conventions to represent that. Okay, let's name it as we have to finalize the structure. You can say we have to finalize the multi-org structure. We'll design and we'll finalize. Say finalize multi-org structure for client. So we have to design enterprise structure. So you can call it as enterprise structure also. So we have to finalize the multi-org structure, or say we have to design the enterprise structure. So after that, the other important point is we have to look at the scope of implementation. Scope of implementation means here the modules. Applications only we call as modules. Okay. We have to find out. How to find out scope of the project here. The scope means there are many ways we just you refer this term scope. So what is the scope of the project means that maybe the status of the project that also we can consider, but here scope of the project means the applications, which applications we are going to implement. So based on that, we have to do the configuration. Say we are going to implement as per the client business requirement, the client taken the license from Oracle for say financials and SCM, supply chain management, and HRMS. Okay, so this is the scope of the project. Okay, this is the scope of the implementation, you can say. The scope of the implementation. Okay, so better you can take the term as implementation. Scope of the implementation. The scope of the implementation is these areas of applications, financials, SCM, and HRMS. Now, what we have to do is, before we, first of all, we just understand the client business and we'll finalize the multi-org structure. Finalizing the multi-org structure means this is how we'll discuss. Then they have to say, okay. Taking the approval from the client, we call as sign off. We have to take the sign off from the client. It is nothing but taking approvals. Okay, we have to take the sign off for the multi-org structure from the client. Within the multi-org structure, again, primary ledger is within the primary ledger. Chart of account is very, very important point. Before we go and create the chart of accounts, I'll take you through the multiple examples. What are the real-time chart of accounts, how it looks like. I'll just show you and I'll explain you. And when you are designing the chart of accounts, what are the points we have to consider? All those points we'll discuss before we go and create the chart of accounts in the system. Okay, for now, we'll see the process, how to start. First, we have to understand the business. Based on that, we have to finalize the multi-org structure. Then we have to look at the scope of the implementation, what are the applications we have to implement. Say, the scope is financials, SCM, and HRMS. In the system, the first step is we have to create the responsibilities for all the applications. This is the first step which we perform when we get the instance from the client. Create responsibilities for all the applications. All the applications means for which applications we have as a scope of the project or say implementation. So we have to create the responsibilities for all the applications. When you say financials for GL, AP, RCM and FA, when you talk about SCM, the primary modules, inventory, purchasing, order management. When you talk about HRMS, there are many applications, but when we are going to work on the financials, so minimum we require one application, that is HR, human resource application. Okay, HR means human resources. That application would be enough for us to do all these activities. So for all those applications, we have to create the responsibilities. Okay. Sorry. And one more point here to understand. We don't need to do anything on the point what we are going to discuss, but just for information purpose, when you talk about project life cycle, basically the project life cycle, the project starts and ends again in between, there will be some activities. When you talk about project life cycle, primarily there are five phases or five stages. The first one is inception. Okay, inception. After that, planning. Then execution. Execution, controlling and monitoring, and closing. Okay, closing. Okay, these are the five phases which we can find in any project. In these five phases, where we involve? Any guess on this? Definitely easily you can find it. These are the five planning phases. Sorry?
Planning and execution, both okay. Phases.
Any other guess?
In project plan.
Okay. Anything else? Any other answer?
Statement of work.
I don't see that in this list of phases.
You can map
with the specific term which we used here. Any guess on this?
Lakshman, can you please repeat your question again?
Sorry?
Requirement gathering.
Do you find requirement gathering in these five? I am asking, these are the five phases you could see in the project, entire project lifecycle management. So out of these five, where we involve? In inception or planning or execution or controlling and monitoring or closing, where we involve? That is my question. Just you can tell me your guesses, that's all.
Controlling and monitoring.
In all okay. The activities.
All the activities we involved, I guess.
Okay.
No, execution.
Execution?
Yeah. Only execution. As a consultant, we involve only in the execution. In the execution, whatever we do, that we treat as a project. The execution process only we treat as a project in our point of view as a consultant. Okay, the execution only project for us. Organization point of view, this entire phases are project. So inception. Inception is nothing but starting the project. How to start the project? There will be sales team, pre-sales team. They'll deal with their clients. They win the project. They do the bidding. They win the project. So once the organization or consulting company win the project, say you are working for IBM and client is, there is one organization, the market XYZ. The IBM contacted IBM, say IBM. You are working in IBM as a consultant. So IBM sales and the pre-sales team will go and contact sales team and the pre-sales. Okay. The IBM sales and the pre-sales teams will go and contact, meet that XYZ company, XYZ organization, and they'll give all the presentations, proof of concept, POCs, and they'll deal with that respective XYZ organization teams, and they'll be presenting how this Oracle application can help them in their business process and how it will help in terms of reporting and security, etc. Everything they'll explain. The IBM sales and pre-sales team will go and talk to that XYZ company. Before that, they'll identify. Okay, they'll identify, they'll find out the prospective customers. So in that, on that base, that is a very, again, big process, sales and pre-sales, but very high level, I want to introduce those points. So the sales and pre-sales team will go on to contact XYZ company and say they just multiple rounds of discussions they had, the IBM team had with XYZ company. Finally, the IBM won the project. Say through bidding process, they win the project. So now they'll start the project that we call as inception. Okay, this would be done by the particular company, IBM. Within the IBM, in every company, we will have a PMO, project management office, will be managing all the project or programs and everything. The group of projects we can call as programs. So the PMO office, they'll initiate the project. That is inception. Then planning. Who will do the entire project planning? The guys who has experience, enough experience, okay, who can do the better scheduling of the project, they do the planning. Normally, if the project managers are senior managers or reporting managers or programming managers or someone else who can do the better planning for the entire project, they do the planning. As a consultant, we don't do anything. Once project is started and planning is done, planning in the sense when the project need to be started, when that is going to end, in between how the entire project will be executed, what are the deliverables, what will be giving to the clients, and all these need to be planned in the sequential manner with the certain schedules, timelines, deadlines, with all those specifications. So somebody will create the planning related document that you can call as PMP document, project management plan document. It's not a project management program. That's that PMP is different from this. So PMP means project management plan. So that should be done by someone. Normally we don't do it. So once inception is done and the planning is done for the project, then we have to start working on the project. We'll involve in the execution. Within the execution only, there'll be start, and in between we just do many things, then it goes to end. So in this execution only we are treating as a project. As a consultant, the execution only we are treating as a project. Project started. If any consultant says the meaning is already inception is over, planning is done, that came to consultant, and we have to start interacting with the client. We take the requirement and we'll just design this multi-org structure and we'll create responsibilities. This is all. So whenever consultant will involve in the project, that is the execution phase only. That execution phase related all the activities which we do, we just take as a starting and ending. So in the execution only, we involve as a consultant to do the implementation. Controlling and monitoring, who will do this? This will be done by project manager. Okay, the project manager has to control and monitor all the project related activities. Okay, they have to anchor between the consulting team and the client, and there are many other things where the manager has to look after. And once the execution is done, and in the execution process only, the manager, project manager, will be controlling and monitoring entire project execution activities. And once everything is done, the project will be closed. Okay, so this is a typical project lifecycle management. So out of this entire project lifecycle management, we involve in the execution. In the execution, whatever we do, those only we call as project started, project ended. Reality, organization point of view, project starting, ending is different from consultant view. Okay, consultant point of view, the execution process only, project for us. Organization point of view, from this first phase to last phase is the project. Okay, so this is the point we have to understand. Now, whatever we are going to discuss, that is related to execution only. Fine. First, we have to create the responsibilities. Okay, how many applications we are going to implement for the client? For all the applications, we have to create the responsibilities. Now, we'll go and create the responsibilities for a few applications. Say, we'll create the responsibility for GL, AP, ER, CM, FA, and PO, OM, INV, inventory, and HR, means HRMS. You can name it as HRMS, Human Resource Management System. Out of that, it's a group of applications, and you say HRMS applications, it's a group of applications, but the usage point of will say HRMS, but the application which will be, for which application will be creating responsibility is HR, Human Resource. For all these applications, we'll go and create the responsibilities. That is the first step. Okay. That is a very first step. After creating the all the responsibilities, we have to assign profile option to all the responsibilities. The fifth step. Instead of saying assign, say set profile option to all responsibilities. The profile option name is HR user type. We'll discuss when we go and set. At the time, I'll explain what is the purpose. Okay. After completing this task, what we have to do is discuss multi-org structure. We have to start creating all these one by one. First, we have to create the business group. So what do you mean by business group? Business group is the one where we can maintain the employees' information. So when you create the business group, for the business group, you have to provide the location. The reality, when you create the business group, we provide location for business group, the address, with which address we have a corporate office or head office. So we have to create the business group to maintain the employees' information. But when you create the business group, generally we provide the head office or corporate office address for the business group definition. Okay, when you create the business group, system will ask us to specify the location. So reality, there is no business group in the business, but in the system we are creating that we are representing the entire organization. With the business group specific country business we are representing, for the entire country there should be some corporate office or head office, that the registration address or corporate office or head office address will be providing for business group. So for that reason, what we have to do is we have to create the location. And before location, just what we can do is we can create the user. This is a sequence we follow. We'll create the user, create user. After creating the user, you can assign all the responsibilities to the user. At the time of implementation, we assign all the responsibilities to user, from which user we are going to do the implementation. Once implementation is done, for each employee, you are going to work on the applications. We'll create the users accordingly. We'll assign the responsibilities. That anyway, we'll discuss detail. But now, as a part of implementation, what approach we follow, we'll try to understand. So we have to create the user. Then we have to assign all responsibilities to user. We have to assign all the responsibilities to user. For all these applications, we'll create the responsibilities all the responsibilities will assign to the user. So after that, you can create location for business group. After creating the location for a business group, we can go and create the business group. Create business group, BZ. After creating the business group, this business group we have to assign to all the responsibilities. Just take these points. Why we have to assign when we are doing in the system, I'll explain by assigning what we can achieve. Okay. After creating the business group, we have to assign business group to all the responsibilities. What you can guess based on this point? We have to assign business group to all the responsibilities. What could be the reason? What you can guess? What information we can have within the business group?
Employee information.
Employee information. So if I assign the business group to, say, for example, payables responsibility, payables responsibility can have access to what?
Employee information.
That's all. We assign primary ledger to GL responsibility. Because of that assignment, the GL responsibility is able to access primary ledger data, right? That's what we have seen by creating the journal. Okay, so if you assign the business group to all the responsibilities, all the responsibilities will have access to employees data which is available within the business group. We'll discuss those points again and we'll see the same. Okay, we have to assign business group. We have to assign the business group to all the responsibilities. Okay, as per multi-org structure, we're done with the business group. After business group, what we have? Primary ledger. Okay, primary ledger we have. To create the primary ledger, what setups we have to complete? Anyone, please tell me. Just follow the sequence and explain. If you want to create the primary ledger, what setups need to be completed? Anyone, please.
First of all, create calendar. After that, create chart of account. Enable currency.
One second. If you are very clear about the setups and sequence, then you can explain. Otherwise, please ignore my question. Each and every setup. Don't ignore any setups. Exact setups and in sequence. Yeah, please, anyone, please. My target is primary ledger creation. What setups I have to complete to create the primary ledger? Tell me in the sequence.
First of all, we need to create calendar in which we need to create a period type and accounting calendar.
Yeah. Create period type.
Correct.
Okay. Next.
Create accounting calendar.
Create accounting calendar. Next.
After that, creation of chart of accounts. So create chart of account.
I'll take a currency. Enable currency.
We need to enable currency, right?
Yeah. Enable currency. Anyway, currency we have to enable before we go and create the primary ledger. At any point of time, you can do it. Okay. Yeah. You can do it after chart of accounts also. Here, no sequence for currency enabling. Okay, fine. Then we have to create
chart of account.
Chart of accounts. We know very well what are the steps involved in the chart of accounts creation. First, we have to create the structure. Then segments, value sets we have to assign to segments, and for segments we have to assign the flex field qualifiers, and we have to freeze and compile the flex field, and we'll create the segment values, right? We'll create the segment values, and we have to assign which qualifiers to segment values. If you are able to answer, it will help you, no doubt. Yeah, please.
Segment qualifiers.
For segment values, we have to assign the segment qualifier. Can you list out those segment qualifiers?
Allow budgeting, allow posting, third party reconcile, account type, and
reconcile.
Those are two different qualifiers. Third party account.
Yes, yes.
And reconcile.
Reconcile.
Fine. So these are all the points you can take with this task. Okay, there are multiple tasks which you perform, but all comes under create chart of accounts. You don't need to go with the detail level. When you're creating the system, we know very well how to create. We'll create it by following the same sequence. We'll execute all the steps. And when you create the new segment value, when you create the segment value, you have to get the permissions also. So that we'll see. For since we are going to create the new user, that we'll be able to test it. For existing users, that is not applicable since the task is already performed. In the real time, when we are going to do the implementation, which approach we are going to follow, the same will do it. So here you can take the point as create chart of account. That means creating the structure, segments, value sets, qualifiers assignment, values creation, everything comes under the same task. Done. After that,
we need to enable accounting method.
Where?
Accounting method should be standard accurate
in our classes. Okay, there is no concept of enabling the accounting method. Fine. So we no need to do anything. We have to create the primary ledger. Okay, there's no concept of enabling the accounting method. We discussed very clearly, we don't need to do anything. We have to enable currency only. Okay, by selecting the calendar, currency, chart of accounts, accounting method, you can create the primary ledger. Okay, done. After creating the primary ledger, as per the multi-org structure, what we have to create?
We need to create legal entity.
Legal entity.
The same we have to perform. Create legal entity. What else? What is the next step?
Assign legal entity to primary ledger.
Yeah, here those points are very important. Those are not inside of the legal entity. That is the reason we have to take as separate points. Assign
legal entity to primary ledger.
Legal entity to
primary ledger.
What is the next task?
Assign balancing segment values to legal entity.
Assign balancing values. BSV. Right? So short we call as BSV, balancing segment values, or else we'll write it. Which segments values we call as balancing segment values?
Company segment.
To which the balancing segment qualifier is assigned, those values are called balancing segment.
You may have a company, but the company values may not be balancing segment values in your client case.
Yeah.
So that is then which segment values we call as balancing segment values means to which segment we are assigning the balance and segment flex field qualifier, that segment values only you call as balance and segment values. All the time, not company. That also we discussed, but 99% company only, but not 100%. That is the reason you should not say directly company values. Fine. We have to assign balance and segment values to legal entity. Then what is our next step?
Assign primary ledger to all responsibility.
So we have to complete it, right? After that, we have to complete the primary ledger. So after completing that, we have to assign the primary ledger to all the responsibilities. So before creating the legal entity also, after creating the primary ledger, we can assign to all the responsibilities. But without legal information, there is no meaning if you are going to have a just primary ledger. So within the primary ledger, what are the companies we have? Those we have to associate with the legal entities. That is the reason we should not assign primary ledger to all the responsibilities the moment you create the primary ledger. You have to complete all these activities, then you have to assign. So after completing that, we have to assign primary ledger to all responsibilities. Okay, we have to assign primary ledger to all responsibilities. That means up to here we will complete. So first we'll complete all these setups. After that we'll discuss further setups and we'll just continue from there. Okay, so we'll get a big list. So instead of listing out all the steps, we'll complete these, then we'll add the further steps which are required as a multi-org structure definition, and we'll do it. Okay, we'll follow the sequence. We'll do that. Yeah, please.
Hey, Lakshman, quick question. If you're assigning the responsibility to a business groups, why do we have to assign primary ledgers? If you're assigning responsibilities to business group, right? Business group responsibilities.
Yes.
So why do we have to assign primary ledger? I thought like it's because it's under business, that same okay. business group, right?
Same we discussed. The primary ledger we have to assign to
responsibilities
with through responsibility only you can record the business transactions, right? If you have AP, for AP you have to assign the primary ledger so that within the AP, when you record the transactions for specific operating unit, you can capture the date, you can capture the chart of accounts code combination, and you can enter the amount that will be represented with the currency which is there in our primary ledger.
Okay.
Yeah. So we'll be assigning the operating unit also to responsibility. Those steps are still pending. So we have to discuss. For now, we discussed up to here only as per multi-org structure. Only these three levels. So further we'll discuss and we'll be doing in the system. Before that, we'll write here. Okay. Fine. The first step is we have to create the responsibilities. How many responsibilities we have to create? When you do the implementation for any one of the client, how many responsibilities we have to create?
9 responsibilities.
No. For any client. For any client, how many responsibilities we have to create?
As many applications they are using.
That is the point. How many applications we are going to implement, those many responsibilities. Say we are going to implement 20 applications for the client. We have to create 20 responsibilities. You may get the question here. So we are learning financials. So we'll be working as Oracle Financial Functional Consultant. Learning this course, if you try for the job, this position you can get. Oracle Financial Functional Consultant. Let's say Oracle Financials Consultant. That is functional. So when we are working as Oracle Financial Functional Consultant, do we need to create the responsibilities for all the applications? Yes, you can create. It's not a great job. Simple task. Implementation we won't do for all the applications. Just responsibilities will create. And we'll start working on finance applications only. Other applications, the relevant area of the consultant will take care of. Okay. So at the time of implementation, how many applications we have for all the applications, we can create the responsibilities. We can create, or else some SCM consultant also can create. It's only the point is, who knows how to create the responsibilities for all the applications they can create. Can be a finance consultant or SCM consultant, some other consultant. Anyone can create because the project is teamwork. But in terms of implementing the specific application, that should goes into a specific consultant account only. Finance consultant only will be implementing the financials. SCM consultant will implement SCM. But this responsibilities creation is not a great job. Okay, who knows which menu we have to use for specific application and which request group we have to use for particular application, they can create it. So to create the responsibility, how to create the responsibility? By selecting the menu. What else?
Request group.
Data group and request group and menu.
Complete answer. How to create the responsibility? By selecting
data group.
Okay. Please go ahead. Go ahead. Just you.
Data group, menu, and request group we need to select.
That's it. So what is the menu name, menu, request group, data group name for GL?
GL super user.
What is that?
GL super user.
What is that? GL super user what?
It's a menu name.
Yeah, that's what you can say. Yeah. The menu name is GL super user.
Request group for GL is
GL program group. Yeah. So for GL, menu is GL super user, data group name is standard, request group name is GL concurrent group name. So you know very well what you have to select when you create the GL responsibility. In the same way, we should know for all the applications, which applications we are going to implement to create the responsibilities for all the applications, you should know what menu for AP, AR, CM, FA, PO, OM, inventory, HRMS, and other applications. And for all the applications, you should know what request group you have to use. Data group is same for all the applications related responsibilities. Okay. So what do you mean by GL? Super user, what does it mean? That is a menu. Whether we are creating or Oracle is providing, what we call?
It's a seeded menu provided by Oracle.
Seeded means which is provided by Oracle. What seeded menu consists of?
Standard functionalities and features.
Yeah. For that particular application, what are the features are developed by Oracle? All you can find within the seeded menu. For GL, seeded menu name is GL super user. In the same way, for every application, Oracle is providing, or you can say Oracle is delivering seeded menus. And for all the application, Oracle is delivering request groups. Okay. For each and every application, what are the features they developed to build the application? All they are including in the menu, and they are providing as a seeded menu. And all the reports they are including in the request group, they are providing for each and every application. So as per our business requirement, as per our client business, we can create our own menus, our own request groups. Those we call as custom menus and custom request groups. Okay, going forward, we'll see those also, how to create our own menus and own request groups. For now, as a part of implementation, always we use whatever Oracle is providing. Okay. Because otherwise, from where you can find that application functionality? We have to use the Oracle provided menus and request groups. Data group is always standard only for any application. Fine. So done. First, you have to create the responsibilities based on the scope of the implementation which you are doing for your client. Okay. To create the responsibilities, first we have to access the instance. We have to log into the instance. For every instance will have so-and-so user credentials. Which user credentials every instance you can find? Any instance. In every instance, which user you can find by default?
Operations welcome.
Okay, good. That means you didn't understand anything from previous classes. Please don't mind. Just what that's what I am understanding. Any other answer?
System administrator responsibility will be there.
I'm not talking about responsibility. I'm talking about the user.
Operations, which operations. That's operation.
Okay, anyone please who attended the classes? We discussed very clearly sysadmin.
Sysadmin.
Right? We discuss very, very detailed level, right? Let's take the time. I'm saving all the files. It's taking time to open that spreadsheet. Well, we discussed, I think, prior to this. We discussed everything. For any instance, sysadmin user, password also, only user instance, we can have operations user. This is what we discussed, operations, services, manufacturing. When we are not speaking, please keep on mute. Please. So we are getting some background noise. That is the reason I'm requesting. Okay, if you are just talking, you are raising some question or you are answering, yes, you can unmute and you can go ahead. But if you are not speaking anything, please keep on mute. So these are the points you should remember. That's what I'm saying, like, just read and remember everything. After completing 14 sessions, if I'm going to ask the question, what is the default user in any instance, if you are answering operations, nothing. Done. So in every instance, we can find sysadmin user. Only in the visual instance, you can find the operations user. That is a sample user. But sysadmin is default user when you buy the product from the, when you take the license from Oracle. In every instance, you can find the sysadmin user. Can we find sysadmin user in the visual instance? Anyone, please?
Yes.
Yes. Every instance, if there is some instance, by default, sysadmin user would be there. On top of it, if you create any additional users, those also you can have. In the vision instance, for a vision company, they created many users. Out of that, one of the username is operations. That's what we discussed. In every instance, you'll have one user called as sysadmin. Fine. Now, when we are working for any client, that means that is a fresh instance. We never use vision instance for any client, only for the training purpose, testing purpose, you may use vision instance. Otherwise, always whatever the instances we'll be using when we're working for any client, those are fresh instances only. In any instance, we'll find sysadmin. So that means in fresh instance also, you can find sysadmin user. So to start with implementation, starting implementation means execution. That's what we discussed. Here's this process only starting. So if you want to start with the application or say instance, you have to log into the instance as a sysadmin user. Okay, the first step is you have to log into the instance as a sysadmin user. That is the first step. Then we'll create the responsibilities. From which responsibility we can create responsibilities?
System administrator.
Yes. From the system administrator responsibility, we can create any responsibility. That's what we did. We created GL responsibility from system administrator responsibility. So who is providing the sysadmin user? Oracle is providing along with the product. So to this user, when you do the implementation, what are the responsibilities we require to do the implementation? Those responsibilities also they are providing along with this user. That means when you access the fresh instance, you can find the user called as sysadmin. The sysadmin user you can call as a seeded user. Whatever Oracle provides, that we call as seeded. The seeded username is sysadmin. To this seeded user, along with the seeded user, Oracle will provide seeded responsibilities also. Why seeded responsibilities are required? The seeded responsibilities will help us to do the implementation. So system administrator responsibility is one of the seeded responsibility. If we don't have system administrator responsibility, what we cannot do? We cannot
create additional responsibilities.
Yes, we cannot create the responsibilities. We cannot create the user. We cannot assign the profile options, right? All we did from system administrator responsibility only in our previous classes. So you cannot do anything. Simply you can say you cannot do anything within the applications if you don't have responsibility called a system administrator responsibility. So that is the reason Oracle provides sysadmin, user, and system administrator responsibility along with that as a CDET. Oracle is providing many other responsibilities also, but those are not for the purpose of recording the transaction. Those for administration point of view, which you can use for implementation purpose. That's all. We'll see now. We'll connect to the instance and we'll log into the instance as a sysadmin user. If you are not spending enough time for this course, there won't be any use. You can understand when we discuss, but enough preparation is required for this. You have to read and remember. If you are answering to my questions, that is really good. Let me close and connect again. So you treat this instance as fresh instance. If it is a fresh instance, how to log into the instance as a sysadmin user? Password also sysadmin. Login. Same process we follow when you do the implementation. When you get instance access, we log into the instance as a sysadmin user. Done. So when you log into the sysadmin, you can find the many responsibilities here which are given by Oracle by default. These you can call as seeded responsibilities. Here you can see one responsibility called as purchasing vision operations. That means somebody assigned to this user. Reality, in the fresh instance, you don't see these responsibilities which are created for a vision instance. The guys who are practicing in this instance just for testing, somebody assigned. Otherwise, you don't find vision operation related responsibilities for this user. Okay, there won't be any vision operation related responsibilities in the fresh instances. Only the point here is when you access to the fresh instance as sysadmin user, you have to go to system administrator responsibility. So here is the system administrator responsibility. Just click on any one of the function. It will take us to system administrator responsibility navigator window. Okay, forget about all the operations users responsibilities and all. There won't be any operations user and vision operation related responsibilities and all, nothing. We'll get instance access. We'll log into the instance as a sysadmin user. After connecting to the instance as a sysadmin user, we have to go to system administrator responsibility. That's all. Rest all you have to ignore. Okay. So this is how straight away we'll be working on the application by following this process. Done. So why we are here? As a part of implementation, the first step is based on the scope of the implementation, we have to create the responsibilities for all these applications. Now we'll go and create the responsibilities for all these applications. From your side, you have to understand how to create responsibility. That hope you are aware of it, how to create. But very important point is for which application, which seeded menu and request group you are using, you should remember all the time. Done. Now we'll go and create the responsibilities. Fine. So take the navigation. What is the navigation to create the responsibility?
Security responsibility defined.
Security responsibility defined. Okay. So security responsibility defined, double click. So what name we can take? So already we use the name called as ERPTREE within this instance. What I'll do is I'll take the naming convention ERPTREE. So take this as a company name. Okay, whatever we create in the system, we'll be using this name as a prefix for everything. Okay, so we are going to create the responsibilities with the ERPTREE name. That already ERPTREE name is used in this instance. All are created already, so that is the reason I have to make some difference. I'm just to keep the unique name. I'm using this naming convention, E-ERPTREE. When you are practicing, you can go with your preferred name. Okay, ERPTREE. First, we'll create the GL responsibility. General ledger. What we have to give? Super user. Super user means who will have access to entire application functionality. Entire application functionality, how can we get? If you select the menu called as GL super user, that's how the responsibility can have access to entire application related features. So at the time of implementation, we require full access to entire application. That is the reason we use the responsible name as a super user, or you can name it as a manager. Instead of writing as a super user, you can write as a manager. I'm just using the term as a super user. You may write as a manager. Done. So we are creating the responsibility against which application? General ledger. Provide responsibility key, short name for responsibility. Since it's a key short name, instead of giving space, I'm keeping underscore. What is the data group name? Standard. So this responsibility data need to be stored in this data group in which area of application? General ledger. What is the menu name for GL? Seated menu for GL.
GL super user.
GL super user. Don't say GL underscore super user and all. Okay. That is the reason I'm asking the question to talk about this point. Okay. GL super user. But you have to write as underscore and all. Okay. What is the request group name for GL? Seated request group.
General ledger concurrent.
Not general ledger. You answered the same in past also. GL. Don't say general ledger. There is no name like general ledger here. Okay. These are Oracle created. You have to just spell how they written. Okay. GL concurrent program group. Now just save it. So GL responsibility is ready. The same way we have to create the responsibilities for other applications. Hope everybody is taking the note. Hope you are writing everything in your notebook or in the system somewhere. Better you can take into notebook. The system will get some limitations to draw something. Okay, fine. So now we'll go and create other responsibilities also. So we'll follow the same sequence, whatever I just mentioned in this spreadsheet. After GL, we'll create the responsibility for AP. So just place the cursor in the responsibility field, click on new. Yeah, please. Any question? I think no. Fine. Now we can create the responsibility for AP. So give the name as, we are using the name as ERPTREE tables. Write the name as accounts payable super user. So we are creating the responsibility against which application? Accounts payables. But application name they given as a payables. Payables means accounts payables. Responsibility key. ERPTREE underscore AP, or else any short name you can write. Data group is same for all the responsibilities, all the applications, standard only. But this responsibility data need to be stored in standard database, the area which is allocated for payables in that area. That is normally technically we call that as a schema. the area which is allocated for a specific application within the database that we call a schema. Within that area only we'll have that application specific tables, and every form will be connected with the relevant tables. And the menu name, what is the menu name for AP? We didn't discuss. The menu name is AP Navigate GUI 12. Okay, the menu name is AP Navigate GUI 12. AP means most of the menus start with the application short name. So navigate. So if you add this menu to responsibility, within this menu, what are the submenus functions we'll have? Whatever we have, those will be displayed in the navigator. GUI means graphical user interface, which you can view. So this is a one of the example. This form is an example for graphical user interface only. So within this menu, what we are going to have, this kind of forms only, but related to payable application. Just they're given as a 12, not because this is the released one. Just they're given the name as a 12 only in the previous versions also. And here request group. For GL, request group name is GL Concurrent Program Group. For payables, request group name is all reports. Just type all reports. See, there are many request group names with the same name, all reports, but you are talking about which application? Payables. That combination you have to select. Request group name for payable is all reports only. Application name is payables. This combination you have to select. All reports, payables. Okay, what is the seeded request group name for payables? All reports. That's all. Then we created responsibility for payables. Save it. Place cursor in the responsible name field and click on new. Or else what you can do is to refresh this form, you can use control down arrow also. Use control down arrow from the keyboard that is equal to clicking on new. Now we'll go and create the responsibility for receivables. You can give the name ERPTREE accounts receivable super user. The application name is receivables. The name wise they are giving as receivables. Reality that is accounts receivable. Receivables responsibility key. ER. Data group is same for any application related responsibility. Your application name is receivables. Menu name is so AR Navigate GUI. So this menu consists of all receivables related features which are provided by Oracle as a receivables application functionality or features. And request group name for receivables. Receivables all. Okay, request group name for receivables. The seeded request group name for receivables is receivables all. Please make a note. Hope you are taking all these points. At least for receivables, what is the menu name? What is the request group name? The best thing what you can do is write all the information into your notebook. One time it will become some sort of practice for you. Fine. Save this record. Save this responsibility. Now we have to create one more responsibility. To create one more responsibility, place cursor here or any place, just say you can place the cursor and click on new. What is the next responsibility? We have to create cache management. And give the name as ERPTREE cache management super user. Application cache management. Sorry,
spelling mistake. ERPTREE.
Okay, I think E is missing. Okay, thank you. Fine. So application name is cache management. So here you can write the name as So cash management, what short name we can take?
TM.
CM, right? We have one more application called as cost management. Okay, we have one more application called as cost management. So cash management, cost management. For which application we have to take the cash management, CM. So what Oracle it is? For cash management, they given the short name as a CE, since cost management application is there. Okay, so CE stands for, you can understand as a cash entry. That means cash related, entry related application. CE you have to take. Or you can say CM also, nothing wrong. But if you have an application called as cash management, cost management, you should differentiate it. What do you mean by CM? Means you can say cash management, nothing wrong. But in terms of segregation, short names and all, so in the application point of view, menu and other definition point of view, for cash management, we use CE. Usage point of view, you can say CM. What do you mean by CM? Means cash management. Data group is standard, application is cash management. And menu name. Menu name, short name, they're taken as CE only. Okay. CE is super user. For cache management, seeded menu name is CE super user. Request group name is all reports. The combination of cache management. All reports, there are many request groups with the same name, but those are segregated application wise. So you have to select all reports. The application name should be cache management. Save OK. Now save it. We created responsibility for cache management also. Just click on new. Now what is the next application? Fixed assets, FA. So you can give the name. ERPTREE. Fixed assets. Okay. So when we are writing any name, please follow the what format you have to write. So when you are writing the fixed assets, don't write fixed assets. You have to write the first letter. Of course, many people know this, but if somebody is there, they can follow this. We know very well what is the meaning of writing everything in the uppercase. What is the meaning of writing everything in the uppercase in the mail or somewhere? It got some meaning, right? It got some expression.
Yeah, it refers that you are strongly telling that when you are writing a quote.
Yeah, we are very angry. That is the meaning of writing in uppercase. Okay. The other case could be if the person doesn't know how to write, they may write. Coding and all, that is different. Coding, that's a different story. But normally, if you write some email or if you write the names in the application, since just company name I'm taking as uppercase, that it's anyway, it's a personalized name and all. So I can take it. So but just follow these rules. Again, don't write the names where whatever you write. Fixed assets. If you write like this, they'll understand our experience. What level of knowledge we have if you write like this or like this. You see in the application anywhere how the labels are given. Same, not uppercase, not lowercase. That rule you have to first letter uppercase and lowercase and again first letter uppercase. This we should follow. That talks a lot when somebody see that. So here name we have to provide as a super user, right? Since we are this responsibility, we'll have access to entire application functionality. Fixed assets, super user. Application name is assets, nothing but fixed assets. FA. Data group is standard, application name is assets, and menu name FA main. Okay, for fixed assets, the seeded menu name is FA main. Request group name is all reports only. All reports for assets. This is the combination we have to select. All reports assets. Save it. Done. Now the next application is PO, purchasing application. Just click on new. ERPTREE purchasing super user. Application name is purchasing. Responsibility keys ERPTREE PO. Purchasing short name is PO. How we are deriving the PO from purchasing? P we have. Where is O? How we are deriving? How come we can? We are taking the short name as PO.
Is the order, purchase order.
Yeah, that is a point we discussed. Okay, so within the purchasing department or within the purchase application, the document, the legal document which we create is primarily purchase order. So in the purchasing application, the legal document which we create is purchase order. So that is reason purchasing application short name, you cannot take P or some other letter. Okay, so that is reason. By referring the key activity within the purchasing application, we are taking the name as PO. What do you mean by PO? In terms of application, PO means purchasing application. In terms of activity, PO means purchase order. But here we are talking about application only. But application name, short name, how it is derived based on the purchase order which we create within the purchasing application. Done. Data group, standard. Application name is purchase. And here menu name, you have to use the menu name called as, so PO. Okay, not that's a purchasing. One second. So purchasing, I don't know, like when I was typing, it is not coming. So purchasing super user GUI, this is a seeded menu for purchasing. And request group name is same, all reports for purchasing application. So this is a combination you have to select, all reports purchase. You should remember all the menus and request groups. Anyway, data group is common, standard for all. So for every application, when you create the responsibility, what is a seeded menu and what is a seeded request group, we should remember. Fine. Then save it. So we're done with purchasing responsibility. The next application is order management. Click on create. ERPTREE order management super user. Application is order management. Responsibility keys ERPTREE, say OM. Data group is standard. Application is order management. And menu name, the menu name is ADSOM. It starts with ADS. ADSOM super menu. So OM means we know order management. Super menu means which consists of all the features. What is ADS? When you talk about OM, OM is a very big and vast application. So within the OM, we discussed as per O2C cycle order process. Along with order, it involves in advanced pricing, distribution, and scheduling, and there are many other activities, functions will be involved as a part of OM. That is the reason by referring those terms also they given ADS. Okay, so in the OM we have a like advanced pricing and the distribution channels and schedule supply chain, I mean shipping execution, shipping management, all we do. So for that reason, just by including those terms they're given as ADS, just remember the menu name as ADS OM super menu. And request group name for OM is OM concurrent programs. What happened? So please make a note and remember, you should remember. So for order management responsibility, we selected seeded OM menu called as ADS OM super menu. And the seeded request group for OM is OM concurrent programs. Why they are writing the menu names differently? For a few applications, they are including the application name. For a few applications, all reports, why they are writing? They written like that, we are following that. Why they written? There may not be good reason. Just they written like that, these are different products. Maybe that product development team might decided to write the names in that way. The same we are following. Okay, then there is no some meaning behind that, why they are writing the different naming convention. For all also, they can give all reports. And they can segregate with the application name, how they did for payables and the cash management and purchasing applications. Done. If they write like that, easily you can find out. Okay, fine. We're done with order management also. Now other application is inventory. Just place cursor here, click on new. ERPTREE inventory super user. Application name is inventory. Responsibility key is ERPTREE INV, right? Short name for inventory is INV. Data group name is standard. Application name is inventory. And menu name INV navigate. Okay, the seeded menu for inventory is INV navigate. And request group name is inclusive all reports. One second. Okay, inclusive, all inclusive GUI. This is a request group which consists of inventory related reports. Save it. We should remember the menu names and request group names for all the application. These are the seeded menus, seeded menu and seeded request group. Done. We create a responsibility for inventory also. Now we have to create the responsibility for HRMS application. Within the HRMS we have many application, but now we are going to create the responsibility only for HR. Okay, we are going to create for HR only. The group of application which are related to HR operations, those we call as HRMS, but we have separate applications like HR. HR means human resources and payroll, and there are many other applications, OTL, Oracle, time and labor, and there are many other applications. Fine. Now we'll go and create responsibility for HR application or call as HRMS application. Just place cursor, click on new, and provide the name as we planned. ERPTREE human resource super user, HR human resource. Application name is human resources. Responsibility keys ERPTREE HR. Data group name is standard. Application name is human resources. HRMS nav menu name. HRMS navigator. You can take, and here you can take HRMS. You can go with HR. You can get common one. HR reports you can take. Okay, or else you are creating this for India, so the HR point of view, HR payroll point of view reports may be different from India and US. Since we are creating this everything for India, you can take the request group for INHR, means this is a request group for India clients. So here you can find what are the reports normally required for Indian clients. Those IN stands for India. The same way for US means US you can select. That's how you can find. Done. So we created responsibilities for all the applications. We're done. Okay. We completed this task. Okay, the next task is we have to set the profile option for all the responsibilities. Which profile option? HR user type. What is the purpose? How to set? And we'll discuss and do it in tomorrow session. And after that, we'll create user. We'll assign responsibility to the user. We'll go one by one in the same sequence. Any questions from today's session, please?